My talk will be about lower bounds for the error of quadrature formulas for Hilbert spaces. And this is joint work with David Krieg, Erich Nowak, and Jan Wybiral. If you want to look at the extended version at the paper, I put the link to the paper, to the archive paper, in the chat. So if I'm too slow or don't tell everything you want to know, just go there. This talk will be most of the time not about random points. If you look at the first row here in my slides, you can basically see what it's about. Random points are just two slides in the end. But the technique may be very interesting for random points even more than I can explain here. So the talk will proceed as follows. I start with, with an introduction. Then I somehow explain the technical connection between lower bounds for error formulas of integration, quadrature formulas, and positive definiteness of matrices. And then we come to some general results and to some applications. And the first thing we want to look at are homogeneous tensor product problems. There will be one general result there and then two applications. Then we, if time permits, go to non-homogeneous tensor products. The main application there is integration in spaces of increasing smoothness. And finally, we come back to the topic of this mini symposium. We are talking about random sample points, and I will give one application also for general result there. So let's start with the introduction, where I would like to fix the setting and the notation and so on. So the main theme of the talk is error bounds for quadrature formulas for integration problems. And we want to integrate functions from a reproducing kernel Hilbert space. So I will abbreviate that by RKHS in the following. And the focus here will not be on upper bounds. It will be on large lower bounds for tensor product problems. So we want to develop somehow a kind of new technique to prove lower bounds for tensor product problems, which shows that certain problems are difficult, whatever algorithm you use. Okay, so this is the generalities, and now we come to the setting and the notation. So we will have functions from a reproducing kernel Hilbert space that will be called F. We restrict to the real valued case, so we have a ground set D where our functions live at. Okay, and reproducing kernel Hilbert spaces are just those Hilbert spaces of functions where function evaluation is continuous. Okay. The kernel will play a major role here in this setting. That's why I fix it next here. The kernel is called K, and it's a function of two variables, X and Y, let's say, which reproduces function values. So F of X is just the scalar product in our Hilbert space F of F with the kernel, where we fix the first coordinate and consider it as a function of the second coordinate. Okay. So our integration problem is a continuous linear solution functional. So we can also talk about general linear continuous solution functionals. Since we are in a Hilbert space setting, we have a representer of this integration functional or solution functional, which is called H. So H will always be the representer. We can get the integral of F by multiplying F with H in the scalar product of the Hilbert space, okay? And what kind of algorithms do we want to consider? As usual, we want to consider some sample points. N will always be the number of sample points here. And X1 up to Xn are those sample points. And we would like to allow general quadrature weights, which we call C1 up to Cn. So a general quadrature formula looks like this here. we have a sum of cj multiplied by f of xj. And since we have linear problems, it's not really a linear problems in Hilbert spaces. It's not really a restriction to consider just linear algorithms here. So the optimal algorithm will always be a linear algorithm like this here. Okay, how do we measure the error? The error is the worst case error, which is given by the difference of our integral s of f minus what our quadrature formula gives us if we apply it to f, and we take the sum over all f in the unit ball of our Hilbert space. Okay, this is the worst case error of the special quadrature formula here, and of course with respect to our integration functional s. Okay, so we somehow would like to talk more about the quality of the points than about the quality of the quadrature formula. The first two lines here are exactly what I had written down on the last slide already. But now we take a further infimum of the errors. We inf over all quadrature weights C1 up to Cn. And this gives us the quality of the sample point set. We take the optimal quadrature formula associated to these sample points here. And this is the same as what is called radius of information and information-based complexity. Okay, this is what you can do with the information f of x1 up to f of xn. And finally, we want to prove lower bounds for all such quadrature formulas. That means we basically want to study the complexity, the difficulty of the problem. And that's why we take a further inf here over all sample points. And that's the minimal possible worst case error we can achieve. And this is abbreviated by E of N and S. So the N here is the number of sample points allowed, but we allow arbitrary sample points here, the optimal sample points, let's say. Okay, so far so good. And then I should explain what I mean by tensor product problems. This slide basically shall tell you what we are looking at if we look at multivariate problems. Again, we look at a reproducing kernel Hilbert space, which is a tensor product. You can take this in the Hilbert space tensor product setting of the Hilbert spaces F1 up to Fd. So we have univariate Hilbert spaces F1 up to Fd on domains D1 up to Dd. And we look at the big domain, which is the Cartesian product of the domains in one variable. And we look at the Hilbert space, which is a Hilbert space tensor product of the single spaces. This will again be a reproducing kernel Hilbert space. And the reproducing kernel is nothing but the product of the single kernels applied to the single variables. So what you do here is you apply K1 to the variables in D1 and Kd to the variables in Dd, and you take the product of that and you get the kernel in the d-dimensional setting. So the small d here will always be the dimension of our problem, okay? And we also want that our integration problem is basically a tensor product problem, which means nothing but the reproducing functional of our solution functional is Hd, which is a tensor product again of the single reproducing functionals here. Okay, so this is our setting, Hilbert spaces, tensor products, and we would like to prove lower bounds for quadrature formulas. Okay, so let me come now to the main general principle behind our results. It's the connection between the errors and positive definiteness of certain matrices. And this can be, this connection can be found on the level of fixed sample points here in this proposition. So let's look at this proposition in more detail. What we have here is our reproducing kernel Hilbert space F, functions on D, kernel K, solution functional S. Okay, and what we want is, look at the last line here, we want an estimate, a lower bound on the quality of the sample points, the radius of information with respect to this integration problem. And then you see here the norm of H squared. The norm of H basically is the initial error, what you can achieve without using any information about your function. This is a supremum of the integral of all functions in the unit ball. Okay. And you want to improve it, and you can improve it by this number here, 1 divided by alpha, if and only if the following matrix is positive semidefinite. So we translate this error bound here into the positive semidefiniteness of such a matrix. And what are the entries of this matrix? What you see here is the kernel matrix applied to the symmetric kernel matrix applied to the sample points, k of x, j, xk. J and k are the indices in your matrix. And what we have to subtract here is alpha times h of xj times h of xk. Okay, so the representer of the integral applied to the sample points again. So we have here two symmetric matrices, and we subtract them from each other. And as long as this is positive semidefinite, we have this error bound here. Let's check for sanity what happens if alpha is equal to zero. Then we have the initial error here. The initial error is actually what we would like to have here. And it tells you that we have this estimate here if and only if the matrix, the kernel matrix here is positive semidefinite. And this is always positive semidefinite. Okay, so because it's the kernel is a positive semidefinite function. So this somehow looks quite reasonable, and this connection is not really deep, but if you write it down, then it gets this nice form here, okay? So lower bounds translate to positive semidefiniteness of such differences of symmetric matrices. Okay, if you translate this to the minimal worst case error, okay, now the difference here is, here, this is for fixed sample point sets. Here, it's for all sample points. And then you just have to get the same condition here, but for all sample points x1 up to xn. Okay. Again, positive semidefiniteness of such a matrix here. So this is the main general result, which is applied in our paper over and over again. And now the question is, of course, okay, we want to have lower bounds here. We go to this condition here. How do we prove positive semidefiniteness of such a matrix? Okay. And this is what I would like to explain here. The general idea is, using properties of the Schur product of symmetric matrices. And I have to explain first what this is, okay? So let's first fix notation for what it means for a matrix E minus A minus B to be positive semidefinite. We write A is bigger than B in this sense. The Schur product of two matrices is just the entry-wise product, okay? We have two matrices of the same size, the same dimensions. We multiply entry by entry and get the Schur product. This is not the usual product, it's a so-called Schur product. And there is a nice theorem about positive semidefiniteness due to Schur, which tells you that if you do this to two positive semidefinite matrices, take the entry-wise product, then again this matrix will be positive semidefinite. This is not a triviality, but it's also not too difficult. And the main tool in our paper now is that you have the following improvement by Wibiral. Jan Wibiral used this technique for the first time in a, let's say, precursor of our paper here, solving one big old problem I'm talking about later. If we have a matrix which is positive semidefinite, and we take the Schur product of the matrix with itself, so we take the square of this matrix in the Schur sense, then we not only get that this square is positive semidefinite, we can estimate it from below by a certain kind of matrix which has entries which looks like this here. If you write down this matrix, it's a rank one matrix, okay? You take a vector here and a vector here and take the product of those vectors, you get an n by n matrix, which is rank one. You divide this by n, and this just means the diagonal of m, okay? So in the case that, which happens sometimes in application, that m has diagonal one, okay? If m has diagonal one, then this is a vector of ones, this is a vector of ones, what you get is the vector of a matrix of all ones, okay? And you divide this by n. So you get a matrix, all entries equal to one divided by n. And this gives you, of course, such an estimate as we would like to have here. We have a difference of two such matrices. This is the rank one matrix here, right? This is the kernel matrix. And if the kernel has somehow the structure of such a product, then we are fine. Then we can use this improvement of Wibiral. And this is basic to our paper, together with extensions of this thing. We also proved some extensions which are applied later. Okay, didn't I want to tell you something about the proof? No, I don't. So let's come to the first applications to tensor product problems. And first to homogeneous tensor products. What do I mean by homogeneous tensor products? The simplification is here. What we do is we take the same Hilbert space in each component and the same problem, the same integration problem in each component, and take the tensor product of that. And for simplicity, we normalize everything to have initial error one, norm of HD equals to one, which basically means norm of H1 equal to one, okay? So let's see what we can get here in this setting of homogeneous tensor products. If we apply, and I think I want to talk a little bit about the proof of this theorem here. If we apply the theorem at the right point in the proof, we get this result. So assume our one dimensional univariate Hilbert space F1 is a reproducing kernel Hilbert space, which contains some special functions. So we would like to have two functions, E1 and E2, from which we get three functions which are orthonormal. And the three functions are the square of E1, the square of E2, and this mixture of E1 and E2. So we would like to have two such functions. They might exist, they may not exist. If they exist, we get something, okay? And we have a connection between our Hilbert space, or let's say these special functions, and the reproducer of our problem. We need that the reproducer is of this form here. So it's also connected to these functions. And we will see an application that sometimes this is really, or in some interesting cases, this is really possible to have such a setting. Then the tensor product problem satisfies such a lower bound here. And we should look at this lower bound a little bit more closely. We see here the initial error, okay? One was the normalization. And then what we can gain is just subtracting n times 2 to the minus d. That means if we want to reduce the error from 1, which is the initial error, to 1 half, we already have to use 2 to the d minus 1 points, okay? Which is what is usually called the curse of dimensionality. We need exponentially many points n to reduce the initial error by a certain factor. So this is a theorem which gives you curse of dimensionality results in an abstract setting, which is applicable to quite some range of spaces. And one of the main features, one of the main things in our paper is applications of these general results here. And I would like to give you two of the applications. Oops, I have to hurry a little bit, I think. Two of the applications here. So sorry about Now skipping the nice proof of the theorem, but what you see down here is the proof from our criterion on positive definiteness of Schur matrices, that such a difference here is positive semidefinite, which then implies the error bound here. Okay, so our functions, our special functions, allow us to construct or to have the kernel in such a way that we can apply this criterion about positive semidefiniteness. But I'm not going into more detail here now, just to keep the time. So the first application already appeared in a recent paper of Jan Wibiral himself. He solved there an old problem of Erich Novak, which is exactly the following setting. We have an orthonormal basis of three functions in the one-dimensional case. This is just one, cosine, and sine. So we get trigonometric polynomials of degree one, okay? And they are contained in any space of smooth periodic functions. So this will be a subspace of many, many Sobolev spaces of very smooth functions, okay? And we prove lower bounds. So we also prove lower bounds for the general case. Did I just get a red card here? Okay, some orange card.
No, it was just a private message that we have one talk less. So you have, it's okay if you need some minutes more.
Ah, okay, that's nice. But I will anyway try to keep the time. So our kernel looks like this then. And our norm looks like this. And here you see that, okay, this is somehow a Sobolev norm. Here it looks like you only consider the first derivative. But if you look at our function, if you take the second derivative, you are back in the same space, right? You get the same functions over and over again. So you can somehow sum up here all the derivatives with some numbers and get this norm here. So this Sobolev norm here actually is one of the standard norms in a Sobolev space of arbitrarily analytic functions, let's say. And what we get is the integration problem of uniform integration suffers from the curse of dimensionality, and we have this nice lower bound here. Novak proved this lower bound for Kvadratchev formulas with positive weights. The proof is very easy and straightforward, but if you don't have positive weights, then it was open for about 20 years, and it was quite present at Erich's web page. He kept the problem there for quite a long time, and Jan solved it in 2020 with this technique I'm describing here. Okay. So the second problem I would like to mention shortly is you are not bound to uniform integration. What we do here is integration with respect to the Gaussian measure, again a tensor product, and again we have a Sobolev space here. And now we look at polynomials of degree two. Again, we fix a small space just to have this subspace here sitting inside many of the Sobolev spaces of higher smoothness. Okay. Our two functions E1 and E2 are now just 1 and x. And if you apply the general result, you get the same lower bound here. Okay. So let's shortly come to non-homogeneous tensor products. What do I mean by them? Right now, what we had was a tensor product of the same spaces. Okay, F1, F2, FD were all the same. And now we take D different spaces, F1 up to FD, also D different solution functionals, and maybe some weights to formulate the problem, right? And then we take the tensor product problem. And what you should get here is, again, we have such a lower bound. It looks a little bit more complicated. The weights in the dimensions are involved. And depending on these weights here, you can again get intractability results, curse of dimension, and so on. One application is, again, to trigonometric polynomials. And the nice feature here is you can handle spaces of so-called increasing smoothness. Okay, if you adjust the alpha I right here, then you get that the norm in Fi is just this integral of f squared, and then you take the L2 norm of the ri's derivative, and if you think of ri as growing, then these weights here are decreasing, and this is what is called spaces of increasing smoothness. And what you can get from this is intractability results, Kirchhoff dimension for such spaces, which in some cases are known, in some cases they are new. So what we also do is reprove some lower bounds for Korobov spaces with product weights with our technique here. Okay, so finally, I owe you to tell something about random points, right? We are in the mini symposium about random points. And what can you get for random points here? Again, here is a general theorem, and afterwards I will give you one application. Okay. The general theorem is like this. You have a one univariate reproducing kernel Hilbert space. The kernel in this case should be non-negative, and the representer of the integration functional should be one. So basically you have uniform integration, but you can do similar things for other integration problems if you write them down in the proper way. The condition you need is that the kernel is bounded away on the diagonal, is bounded away from one. Okay, it's bigger than or equal to one for trivial reasons, and it has to be bounded away from one to apply our result or make it meaningful, let's say. And what you then get is, if you take sample points randomly, meaning independent and uniformly distributed in your domain of integration, and you take the error of your quadrature or of your radii of information and average that, then you cannot be better than 1/4 whenever n is smaller than this exponential number here. So again, you have the Kirchhoff dimension, but now for random points, right? This is not telling you directly anything about the optimal points, it's telling you something about random points. And a nice problem to show an application of this is the following problem. Again, we are in a small space, a space of polynomials of degree 2 on an interval, and we take the homogeneous tensor product of that. The norm in the one-dimensional case is just the L2 norms of f, f prime, f double prime squared and summed up. So the tensor product space consists of polynomials with mixed order 2 or less. And this was part of, or it is an open problem, still an open problem actually, to show that integration on the tensor product space suffers from the curse of dimensionality. Okay, this is one of the open problems in the books of Erich Novak and Henryk Wozniakowski. And it still is open, as I said, it remains unsolved for optimal point sets. But what we can show is that the theorem, or our theorem shows that the curse of dimension holds for random point sets. Okay. What you get from the theorem applied to this situation is you cannot, in average, reduce the error from 1/1/4 by using less than exponentially many points, okay, which is the curse. Okay, again, this is only with independent and uniformly distributed points, but this is the most natural choice in this case, of course. So basically, I talked a little bit longer than I was allowed to, but Mario said I was allowed to. So thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Eike, for your talk. Is this the clapping button? Great. yeah, there's a clap clap of Michael. Great. So are there any questions of the guys in the audience? If yes, please, oh, there's a chat. Oh, no, it's Michael. So if so, please put it in the chat and I can make you loud and you can ask. During this, maybe I can ask a question. So here you use IID points. So for the random things, you use IID points and say something about the expectation there. Are there any hope to use, say, more advanced methods like concentration bounds or something to come closer to the open problem, or are there already any attempts to?
I guess so. I think we discussed this already a little bit, but it was some months ago. I think what you don't really need is this condition here, right? So basically what you need is that you have this infimum away from one with high probability for the d-dimensional case, okay? So concentration results will help here and can be applied here, okay? So this condition here is a little bit too strong, or is too strong for this result. You can, I don't have a special example now in mind, but you can use concentration results showing you that this happens here, not in the inf, but with very high probability, and then you will get the same result.
Yes, but then your lower bound on the error also holds with a certain probability. But what I meant is under this, maybe under the strong condition you pose here, is it possible to say something about every point set? Using, don't know, some concentration results or whatever? Or is this out of reach?
I mean, I guess that this result, or this result is true for arbitrary point sets, but I don't see that you can get anything if you, even if you prove something with very high probability, you still would need some kind of continuity in the error or something to achieve, to come close to every point set.
For example, using some, if the functions are periodic or something, and you can check that if some point set is good, then also and other point sets are good.
In the neighborhood. This is what you would somehow need, right? Okay. That, I mean, you have some room in these theorems because this positive definiteness gives you a lower bound away from zero, so you somehow can also tweak the points, right? If you have a nice kernel and you can handle those differences, maybe you can use the theorem, the lower bound for these positive definite matrices also somehow in a neighborhood of certain points, but I really didn't think about it. I don't know. But a chance, I would see a chance there, yes.
Thanks. So, any other questions? Yeah, Michael, I can make you loud, okay? Fine. You can ask your questions. So, of course, it does not work. I put you now.
It's hard to, I'm not used to these Zoom buttons and so on. In some cases, in the conditions of your theorems, the kernel or the representer functional had to be positive or non-negative, right?
Always, I think, because you have a square there and this will be positive. The kernel has to be positive.
Right, that's mostly because you want your machinery to work, right? But so if it's not satisfied, you don't know that maybe the results don't hold, probably you don't have a clue, right?
No, we don't really have a clue. So the problem would be to somehow remove this condition on the kernel where we can prove something, right? Here, here maybe it's seen here what the restriction in our case is, the main restriction. It's that the kernel is a sure square of this here. So it has to be positive, right? We have some results also for kernels which are products of two different M's, where you know something about the positive definiteness here. And you can get a little bit, but I think you always need that K itself is positive. So this is a restriction of our method, but it doesn't tell you that, here you can see it again, right? The tool is a sure square, but this of course is unconditional on K. You don't need positive definiteness or positivity of the kernel here.
Yeah, of course.
And that's why this, it might be possible to use something like this also for other kernels, but there are some restrictions in our approach here, but basically due to technical reasons, right?
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So if there are no other questions, then let's thank Eike again.